Hello and welcome to Business Television India. You're watching The Market Guru with me, Piyush Jain. Today we have been joined by Mahesh Patil, the Co-Chief Investment Officer at Aditya Birla Sun Life AMC. Mr. Patil, welcome to the show. Now, first of all, let's talk about, and there are so many moving parts I want to talk to you. But when I look at the sort of liquidity scenario, what actually we've been looking at in the last 2 or 3 months, different events again, in terms of credit events related to ILFS. But the good point this time here is the equity inflows have remained very strong. And when we look at the global markets broadly, how do you look at the markets at present? From a sort of strong equity inflows, from the sort of sharp fall in crude price, the sort of fluctuations we have looked at the bond yields, how is it looking to you?
Yeah, I think so. In the last month or so, a lot of things have changed. So a month back, things were looking pretty bleak and markets were in a correction and looked like they'll probably make slightly newer lows. But in the last one, a lot of the macro headwinds, okay, which were there for the markets have clearly eased off a bit. I mean, one is, as you mentioned, the crude oil prices having corrected by almost 30%. So real concern for India was the current account deficit, which was kind of getting towards around 3% or so. And even the capital flows were pretty weak, both FII flows into debt and equity. So that was putting a lot of pressure on the POP.
In fact,
negative.
Now the first month, FII has again become net bias in the debt market.
Yeah, yeah. So we'll come to the liquidity, but I think purely on the on the current account and the BOP challenge, which was there with the $30 billion kind of a negative. So the pressure on rupee was there, and that had its impact on the market. And oil was looking to actually go higher. People are talking about oil going to around 90 plus. And then we had this sharp correction in oil prices, which kind of improved the overall scenario. And I think on the liquidity side also, domestic flows, as you mentioned, in the month of October were very strong because there was a concern that because of the market correction, and a lot of the SIPs were, on a one-year basis, were looking giving negative returns. And also because of the all noise around the market in terms of the credit crisis and the liquidity issue, one would have thought that the flows would have kind of lowered, right?
Yes, yes.
But actually we saw almost 20-25% increase in flows, okay, compared to the run rate which was there in the preceding
and
few months.
This time it has been very different since what we have been so used to seeing over the last many cycles.
Yeah, so I think what investors seems to have done is that in the market correction, I mean, with the market Nifty correcting by almost 10% from its peak in the month of October, I think people have actually used that correction to deploy some more and get into the market. And so clearly, I think retail investors are looking maturing, and they're not looking at the market from a short-term perspective, overlooking the volatility and taking a longer-term view on the market, I think, which is a very healthy sign. And at the same time, in the recent couple of weeks, even on the international flows, FII flows also have turned mildly positive, though nothing dramatic, but the huge negative outflow what we saw in the month of October, which was almost like more than $2 billion. So that again clearly has ebbed. And the reasons for that probably is that I think on US itself, there have been talks about some kind of the growth probably might not be as strong as next year. And with the elections in the U.S., okay, where the Democrats have taken over the House, so there's a feeling that the Trump policies, which were probably more pro-growth in terms of big fiscal stimulus, would not be as strong, and that would lead to slightly weakening of the dollar, okay, which is good for emerging markets because the dollar strength was what was leading to the capital outflows from emerging markets. And in turn, in India, the outflow was not India-specific, but the outflow what we saw from the emerging markets. So that, I think, pressure has eased off, and even the rate hike scenario going forward, there is some kind of a view, okay, which is there, some kind of a dovish view which has come in from the Fed.
In fact, they said that we are nearing the neutral rate now.
Yeah, so neutral rate anyways would have still meant almost 3 to 4 rate hikes because that is around 3 to 3.25%. So, but I think even that scenario looks to be slightly getting pushed away if the growth in the U.S. next year is not as strong. But that bodes well for emerging markets.
And
right?
That's why the FIIs came back to the Asian debt market, including the Indian debt market.
Yeah, so I think kind of a weaker dollar, or at least not for the strength in the U.S. dollar, would mean that capital flows could come back into emerging markets after a long pause. I mean, you've seen the emerging markets underperform significantly compared to the developed markets, and more specifically the U.S. I think that trend, if could reverse, okay, going forward and probably next year in a bigger way. And that also bodes well for liquidity in terms of foreign inflows into Indian markets. So I think looking at all these scenarios, the macro, okay, one is the easing of oil prices, the liquidity situation improving, and also the credit crisis which was looming around on the NBFC space after one of the large defaults which happened, and the liquidity challenge, and that also has eased off considerably in the month of November. So there was a challenge in terms of large rollovers which were there on the NBFC space to the extent of around more than around 1.5 lakh crores in this month. So we've seen significant of the rollovers going through. So
it has been a smooth rollover.
It's been a, yeah, I mean, it was looking challenging initially, but it's picked up in the last couple of weeks. And thanks to the support given by the government and also RBI intervening to provide more liquidity. So that crisis also seems to have averted at this point in time. And that actually has really capped the downside to the market, right, which was looking a bit negative. And while there are no immediate triggers for the market to really push up, there are still challenges on the global front. But clearly, I think market should stabilize. Mild corrections would be expected.
And when you say mild correction, like what's your own expectation? Because then I will come to you on the cash deployment question.
Sure. So I think earlier we were looking at, even in a bullish market, one could have, looking at the macro concerns which were there, domestic and global, I mean, one could have looked at around 20% or more correction also in the market. I think from its peak, so markets had already corrected around 10% when it touched the recent lows. And one could have expected...
Yes, from the recent lows, in fact, 15%, 11,800 to 10,000 all the way.
Yeah, yeah, okay, yeah, closer to that. So, but I think from here now, I think a correction of, again, I think probably the recent lows should hold on pretty well. So that means a correction of around 6-7% or so from these levels. Which
that's
is
fair enough. That's a good opportunity for investors. And it's a,
yeah, it's not going
that
to be
sort
a
of shallow
yeah,
correction. You
yeah,
think.
I think so. Because looking at the macro, I think that fear is now out of the window. I think the market might remain consolidated probably for some time in a band, because we have elections and other challenges over here. And growth is, while it's coming back, is coming up slowly. It's not like very strong growth. In fact, for this year, we still see some kind of a downgrade. I think at the beginning of the year, we were coming
between
up pretty
20-25%, that was the estimate. Like, what was your own expectation on earnings growth?
Our expectation was around 18%.
Okay.
At the beginning of this.
That was lower end of the street estimate.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
You were anyways conservative.
Yeah, but I think that number would still be lower. I think it could be somewhere around 13-14% number.
So downgrades that still have to trickle in.
Yeah, yeah. So it's already happened, I think, after this quarterly numbers. So this quarter numbers were okay. I mean, actually, number of companies surprising positively or in line was still around 70-75%, but a lot of companies had negative surprises, especially in the auto sector, in the cement sector, and some in the and some of the other spaces, which has led to a downgrade to the earnings.
Right.
So the pace of growth is good. I mean, it still be double digit growth after a long time, but nowhere near the earlier expectations. That would also probably cap the upside in the near term. But I think clearly for long term investors, the outlook looks fairly decent now. I think the macro headwinds which have kind of eased off, even interest rates which are looking to really move higher, right?
The yields have cooled off almost 50 basis points just in a span of 2 months.
Yeah, so one is inflation has been pretty benign. I mean, there were fears that inflation would move up because of oil prices, the transmission of higher oil prices across various commodities would lead to high inflation, and also the rupee depreciation, right, because that also has an impact. But inflation print was well below the RBI target range. Food inflation remains very low, and that also has really taken away the concerns about further increase in the policy rates. And the bond yields also have given away about almost like 40-50 basis points.
What I've observed is there is a sort of a change in the trend here. The street now actually has started to like more the stock like Axis Bank, ICICI Bank, SBI. Earlier again they were liking more IndusInd Bank, HDFC Bank. There's a trend change. We can talk about the wholesale banks from that recent perspective. But are you also again basically following this sort of, or you are also seeing this sort of outperformance prospects over a medium term from this pack?
Yes, we'll come to that. So one on the banking sector, so one is clearly credit growth should improve, okay, which we are seeing this year itself. It's now closing somewhere touching in the mid-teens, which used to be like in the low and the high single digits, right? So that is positive. Even margins improvement could be there because the whole NBFC problem has meant that the banks have got some pricing power back, right? And they are taking their pound of flesh.
Also market share.
Yeah, and some market share.
Most of the banks actually are raising debt or equity again by large amounts.
Yeah, so I think that's broadly good for the banks. Within the banks, as you mentioned, right, clearly banks with a good liability franchise, with good CASA ratio, good retail deposits, I think should be at a better advantage in this scenario compared to the wholesale banks, is what our view is. And within the retail and the corporate banks, I mean, retail banks have been doing well. I mean, they have been good compounders over the last decade or so, and they'll continue to do so. I don't see any challenges over there. But there is some shift clearly happening towards the corporate banks because of the valuation big differential. So the corporate banks were quoting at below their long-term multiples, price to book value multiples, and with the outlook improving at the margin, so there is some kind of a PE rating which potential which is there in these banks, and that's why the outlook there looks slightly better relatively, I would say. I mean, obviously the private banks, the retail banks will also do well, but relatively delta would be more towards the corporate banks. Not all the corporate banks, but selectively, okay, as I mentioned, which have got a strong good liability franchise, have cleaned up their book really, and that comfort is there, and have got a strong leadership at the top which could drive them for the next leg of growth. I think that's where the incremental allocation on performance could come over the next 2 years.
So how does an institution think, like at the sort of helm for the sort of strategic allocation, do you look at the banks which are either facing management transition or have already again seen the management transitions, along with the asset quality? Definitely you'll be actually checking out in terms of how the prospects are looking like. Are those turnaround candidates basically also actually coming up at present in terms of capital allocation, or are they also looking better? Or I'm asking from the investor's point of view, or the traditional compounders which actually have done well and again have been seeing very sort of stable management profiles, how one should be actually seeing at present?
So I think now it opens up across the board, right? Earlier you only, probably we were more focused, our overweight was significantly towards these compounders, retail banks with long stable management. But now with the change in the macro and also changes in the top management and some of the banks, it opens up a wider opportunity increase for us. And then it comes down to relative valuations vis-a-vis growth, where the risk reward is favorable. So that's how we would look at it. I mean, you always have the compounders and the stable banks in your portfolio. But the other banks also, which we were not so, we market or was not looking at it, I think those are also now under our consideration set when we are looking at it. I mean, obviously, valuations and other things you would look at in terms of deciding, okay, where you want to be more overweight relatively. But I think the options are much broader in the banking space, I would say.
So it's better than PSU banks. Do we intend to deploy more money into PSU banks if the sort of NPA increase, the slippages, that trend is slowing down? Are the valuations looking good, or they still will remain slightly underweight?
PSU banks still have some challenges because of a capital issue in some cases. Some large banks, again, the mergers, okay, which have been talked about. So that could be a drag for some of the PSU banks. And again, the leadership issues in some of these is still not really sorted out. So the investable universe in the PSU banking space becomes very, very limited.
SBI of the world, the Bank of Baroda,
yeah, some of
the top,
very,
the top
very, 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 very limited. Okay, one can choose where it is. But yeah, so while PSU banks, some of them could probably emerge out of this crisis and do well, but they have other challenges, push and pulls. Getting in the election also, there is a lot of government lending, farm loan waivers. So all these things would weigh down, and the valuations there might not really relate to that extent. But yeah, selectively, large PSU banks can also be, or we are also evaluating those.
Right. So private banks, definitely, again, actually, this time we have a wider basket. But now, traditionally, last two general election years, the last year, the fifth year, Actually, that actually has given us always three themes, and those have worked. This basically the data shows, and that's consumers, the consumption theme, the pharma theme, and the IT theme. Now, consumption theme basically did well, and there was a point again when everybody started talking about are the valuations too rich. Then we actually saw a pullback here. How's the entire consumption, whether it's discretionary or non-discretionary, is looking to you, and what you're liking at present?
So the consumption play has been doing fairly well overall, most of the consumer staples. And we've seen some kind of improvement in terms of the growth over there, volume growth, which was weak a couple of years back because the rural economy was not doing that great. So that has picked up, and some kind of a pricing power come back. GST also has helped some of these consumer names really to get more efficiency from their supply chain. And that has led to margin improvement, and earnings there look fairly decent over there.
But we're very happy with the volume growth this time.
So the volume growth was fairly not bad. I mean, if you look at the first quarter numbers, second quarter, there was slight disappointment in one or two names. But by and large, the volume growth was better than compared to last 2 years, what we have seen, right? So so I think it is pretty much in line. And the valuations there have been a bit expensive. So we saw some correction in the consumer staples recently. They have again kind of clawed back. But I think in any correction, mild correction, and these stocks start to look good with a steady earnings growth profile going forward, because overall the market return expectation and earning growth is still going to be muted, right? So in that scenario, some of the consumer names, even though the earnings growth might not be very exciting, but I think in the low teens or mid-teens growth, they can still deliver, and that is what one would look at it. Obviously, the entry points in some of these names can be really needs to look into it, because the multiples are not exactly, they are probably much higher than the long-term averages.
What's their own sort of weighted scenario at present consumption? And when I'm trying to ask it, let me make it more directional here. Like compared to the last 3 year average, are you still overweight where you're in consumption?
So yeah, compared to the last 3 years, we are slightly higher weightage. So see, consumption, purely consumer staples, we might not be overweight vis-a-vis the benchmark. And a lot of the fund houses would be significantly underweight. So relatively, we are better positioned over there, I would say. Our weightage has increased more than what it was around 2-3 years back. But it will still be a mild underweight vis-a-vis the benchmark, purely on the valuation basis.
Right, and discretionary.
But discretionary consumption, where we are slightly more positive, though I would admit that in the last quarter, the numbers haven't been that great. So there have been some concerns. Slowdown in growth for discretionary consumption, some margin pressures because
especially in the rural part, right?
Rural part across the board, I would say. Again, in autos also, two wheelers, consumer durables like air conditioners and other consumer durables. But we think it's a kind of a temporary phase over there, because discretionary consumption in India has long term growth potential. Looking at the per capita incomes, okay, where they are. Rising income levels, and also benefit from unorganized to organized.
And then expansion of middle class.
So that is a long-term story which will play out.
So dips are opportunities at present for you.
Because the stocks had run up, the valuations had moved up. I think we've seen a good correction in some of these stocks. So the valuations have now become reasonable. And I think mild challenges, short-term challenges, short-term dips because of various factors, I think those will even out, and they could be good long-term.
If I just want to ask you one sub-theme, because I know for compliance reasons I can't ask you stocks, but for sub-themes perspective, whether it's air conditioners or we're talking about other discretionary items, what would be that one sub-theme again where you think you're the most bullish on?
So I would say that whether it is themes like consumer durable names, okay, not high ticket but low ticket consumer durables, okay, that will do well. Autos also, I think, post the correction, the valuations have come off. So auto ancillaries, though they are not directly consumer discretionary, they are dependent on the, but autos would qualify under that. That looks good. Some of the paint companies again look good, and even air conditioner, this year is a bad year, okay, for the companies, but I think that's purely because of the seasonal, I mean, the weather conditions that should not repeat. So we should see growth coming back strongly next year.
Appliances also are positive on large and neutral?
No, appliances also. When I say consumer durables, that means appliances. Yeah.
Right. Fine, so that's something interesting space again, which definitely Mahesh is liking, but Also, let's talk about the infrastructure companies. Long-term prospects, again, funds like you, or I should say again, there is usually a very sort of long-term project, so long-term value creation, but the stocks are beaten down. Order books actually are telling you very strong order books, maybe 3 years, some stocks 4 years, some stocks 2 years, revenue visibility there. How the stocks position, are you liking them? And it's election year, so how one should be judging these stocks?
So on the construction sector, we've seen very good correction. A lot of the mid-cap name, because most of the companies are in the mid-cap space, and the larger correction in the mid-cap has had its toll on these names. And some of them are typically, when interest rates go up, they tend to react. So I think the increase in rates recently, what we have seen, has also had its toll. But the companies are sitting, as you rightly said, on good order book position. More importantly, the execution is fairly strong. So we have seen the number this year. The top line growth has been very strong, and that typically happens in an election year, where you see good execution at the ground level, because a lot of the, local government, they want to show execution.
Projects will finish very quickly.
So our order book might get a bit challenged just 6 months before the elections.
Right.
But that's not a challenge, because they're sitting on already good order book, which has a visibility for the next 3 years or so. And post-election, you should see order book again pick up over there. So I think, some of these names, where the balance sheets are fairly okay, they don't have any balance sheet issues, I think they should do well over the next. I think post-elections is where they could again start to really do well in terms of re-rating of multiples. So it's a good time to really accumulate some of these good quality names in the construction and infra name. And also in the capital goods sector, we've seen early signs of pickup, though nothing.
The results actually were showing strength.
Results were showing some kind of a strength, though I think private sector capex would still take a year's time, but clearly capacity utilization levels are going up. And I think, again, post-elections, you might see that sector really catching momentum. So, again, selectively in the capital goods sector, I mean, these are the cyclicals, which I think, so the broader theme would also be like domestic cyclicals would really come back in play, because last 6 months or so we've seen some of these stocks beaten down, and the global cyclicals were taking center stage, right, because of the strong US economy, the depreciation of the rupee. So those things are kind of reversing a bit now, what we are seeing. So that could be a shift in a kind of a sector rotation, which thing we could play out over the next 6 months or 1 year time frame.
So good times again. It's more about the stock picking, as you're talking about.
Yeah, so it will remain stock picking, because sectors rotation and this thing is happening very fast, and that way everything is well balanced, right? Valuation wise, sector which are looking good, they are already looking good. So yeah, it should be more stock specific, and the correction in the market really gives an opportunity, really, because we've seen the volatility in the stocks and the correction across the divergence across stocks. So that gives a better opportunity for a stock picker to really get stocks at the price which one has been looking forward.
Manish, thanks a lot for coming on the show and sharing your insights on the markets and the themes. And that was our interaction. Manish, it's still sounding positive. There are a lot of good opportunities, as he's talking about. Consumer discretionary, durables, again, all of that, again, he's liking at present. Also, we talked about corporate banks largely the private banks. Opportunities have increased there. Again, he's also comfortable out there. Also, auto ancillaries, autos, again, as the part of consumer discretionary, again, all of that, again, basically is looking quite good. But broadly, the markets actually are giving opportunities to invest. That's the sort of takeaway from our discussion today. And with that, it's a wrap on this edition of Market Guru. Thank you so much for watching us.